The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Oh, once she grabs, she won't let go. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole. Rock, rock, rockin' Nicole.
None of that soft stuff.
Rock, rock.
None of that heavy metal stuff.
Rock, rock, rock,
just a little bit of jazz.
Rock, rock, rock,
what do you think?
Just I love it. That was great. Thank you.
Big laughs, applause.
We always knew that congressmen were available for sale, and you could purchase them from anywhere, even if you were in jail. And now there's even better news to get your private interest to advance. I mean financed, cause the Supreme Court's up for sale, and it don't involve blackmail, it's a song and dance. Benefits enhanced. It seems Supreme Court justices have at least one billionaire that they ride around on jets with, and they never pay no fare. Then they make decisions favoring the guy who paid the bill. They don't have to follow rules, and they probably never will. Judge Alito got himself a $100,000 ride to a luxury vacation. No quid pro quo was implied. Of course, that didn't have an impact when it finally was the time to decide. Took that in stride on a case involving all those folks that gave him those lavish strokes. No ethics were ever applied. For the last two decades, Court Supreme has gutted all the laws that kept the powerful from buying public servants for their cause. Their cause was nothing more than self-interest to the greatest of degrees. So now the wealthiest can buy all the access that they please. That's why Clarence Thomas thinks his actions are of no import, although he's taking millions from claimants who came before the court. Luxury vacations, private schools, trips on jets and trips on yachts. The things he plots, undisclosed despite the rules. The public that he thinks he fools, as a judge, he is their sots. The Supreme Court turns a blind eye to its self-corrupting course. Any rules that apply, they're designated to enforce. Self-regulation, not a strong point with the human race. They can't be fired from their job, so they don't need to say. It seems Supreme Court justices have at least one billionaire that they ride around on jets with, and they never pay a fare. They always sing the same old song, innocent as a dove. They say that they've done nothing wrong. Who does that remind you of?
Oh, yeah. The Parody Project. His name is Don Karen, and he does these songs. It was another, you know, last week when Lisa Graves was here, we were talking about the court. I played the Parody Project's parody of Tom Dooley, and it was pretty epic. In fact, our pal Spocko, who writes at Digby's Hullabaloo at digbysblog.net, has a piece up today, and he actually took that song, because it's kind of long, and he sped it up a little bit, edited it and sped it up, so you can catch it over there. I may check in with us. Bucko's in the chat room. I may read you a little bit of his piece today. I believe Spocko is out being a poll watcher today, which thank you, Spocko, for doing that. It is our civic duty. It's today's Super Tuesday. Not that anybody is really paying much attention, because there's no suspense there. We know what's going to happen. I heard someone refer to it as Super Snooze Day. Sorry, I should. When I say something like that, I should do this. I should always have that rim shot handy, right? So, you know, no big suspense as to what's going to happen today. We know, I shouldn't laugh. Apparently, you know, MSNBC brings in the big guns. You know, Rachel Maddow is there for every election night and when there's a big breaking news story. Well, apparently, let me pull up the site so I don't get it wrong. Apparently, MSNBC had to evacuate their whole broadcast floor of Rockefeller Center. I'm still looking for it. Because there was a bed bug here. Bed bug sighting prompts MSNBC to clear entire New York City studio floor ahead of Super Tuesday coverage. Bed bugs are not funny. And I remember when Air America had bed bugs. Now, I never broadcast. I did one time when I visited New York for a few days. I broadcast from the Air America studios. But when I was on Air America, I did it from my home studio like I do now. But of course, in Florida, not here. But bed bugs, oh, just, ew. Nothing, very few things make my skin crawl like the idea of bed bugs. Here's what it said. Mediaite is who had the story, of course. A source close to MSNBC confirmed to Mediaite today that the network briefly shut down the third floor of their New York office out of an abundance of caution after a bug sighting. I wouldn't even know what a bed bug looks like. Do you know? The New York Post originally reported yesterday about the bed bugs found at Studio 3A at 30 Rockefeller Plaza. Studios across the third floor in the building were cleared out after a bug was spotted. I wonder if there's a picture. No? An exterminator was brought in as well as an environmental canine detection team for a final pass before workers could return to their offices. This is the definition of skin crawling. Wah! All right. So, yeah, I digress a little bit because there's obviously bigger things going on than the bed bugs. So the big story tonight is, of course, the extreme court. And I just got to share this with you because it shows that even the smartest among us, they have certain challenges. I am time zone challenged, okay? And, you know, I've always, except for 4 months when I lived in Taos, New Mexico, and the time I've been here in Arizona, I've always lived either on the East Coast or the West Coast. I'm a coastal person. So I can do Eastern time. I can do Pacific time. But when you get into these middle time zones, I just can't figure it out. It's like I have a mental block. So Lisa Graves, I had booked her last week to come on today, just having a feeling that there was going to be some action. There's always a legal issue to talk with Lisa Graves about. And of course, this time it is the Supreme Extreme Court, or the Supremely Extreme Court, as is what I should call them. She had her assistant confirm with me yesterday. And the thing is, I'm in Arizona. Okay, we're on mountain time. But see, on Saturday night, Sunday morning, the rest of the nation will spring forward because daylight savings time begins. But not here in Arizona. And I was like so happy. It's like, we don't have to change our clocks. It's going to be great. It's going to be, you know, life will be so much easier because it takes me a while to adjust. And of course, Jackson, my dog, doesn't adjust. And he gets me up these days at 5 o'clock in the morning to take him out. So, you know, I'm already sleep challenged as it is. But anyway, so Lisa's person, I think her name is Sarah. Pardon me if I got it wrong, emailed me and she said, okay, so what time she's available, like 2 to 4 and whatever central time. And I'm like, oh God, now you're throwing another time zone at me. So I said, well, I'm on mountain time. And what I always do is use Eastern and Pacific time. Even though I'm in Arizona, when I book a guest, I usually just use Eastern time, unless I know they're in California, and then I use Pacific time. Well, this time I attempted to say, okay, you're a central time. I think you're an hour behind me. See, and this is where I get confused. Anyway, I look up at my email and I see that at like 1:30, Lisa logged into the Zoom. It's like, oh shit, I think I got the time wrong. And so she will join us right in about 20 minutes, the bottom of the hour. We'll have a half hour with her. So I'll save the Supreme Court stuff for Lisa. But here's the thing that I'm getting at, just to warn you, see what I do for you. Everyone else will spring forward on Sunday, right? Saturday night, Sunday morning, but not us. So all things will remain the same. Well, nope. No, what's going to happen here is because everyone else moves an hour ahead, I'm an hour behind. I guess, again, time zones and me don't get along. The bottom line is, right now, it is 3:11 here in Arizona. So though I'm on at 5 Eastern, 2 Pacific, I'm on at 3 in Arizona. Except when the rest of the country springs forward, we stay the same. I will go on the air at 2 o'clock, not 3 o'clock. It doesn't change when you listen. Nothing changes for you because you're in, I'm guessing, part of the country or the world that changes the clocks. We don't. So the bottom line is I don't lose an hour of sleep, but I lose an hour of show prep time every day. And if you saw me between 2 and 3, you'd know that I'm scrambling at the last hour. I save everything for the last minute. And I'll be confused along with it. So next week, I will try not to be late. But, you know, such as it is. So that's not the only thing that we've got going for us here in Arizona. Oh, no. We have a now soon-to-be former senator because Kyrsten Sinema made it official. You ready for this one? Hold on. Yeah, that's old Kyrsten. And what is she going to say to us?
In 2017, I warned we were approaching a crossroads.
You did.
Our democracy was weakened by government dysfunction and the constant pull to the extremes by both political parties.
Yeah.
I promised I would do my best to fix it.
Okay.
To protect and defend our Constitution. To listen to others without
judging. Oh, right.
To focus on what unites us,
yeah,
and to make Americans' lives better.
Uh-huh.
Through listening, understanding, and compromise, we delivered tangible results that make America safer, stronger, and more prosperous.
Okay.
Yet, despite modernizing our infrastructure,
uh-huh,
ensuring clean water,
yeah,
delivering good jobs and safer communities, Americans still choose to retreat farther to their partisan corners.
Well, we have a two-party system here.
These solutions are considered
here
failures. Either because they're too much or not nearly enough.
Mm-hmm.
It's all or nothing. The outcome, less important than beating the other guy. The only political victories that matter these days are symbolic.
Attacking
okay, get
to the point,
on cable
Kyrsten
news or social media.
You would know.
Compromise is a dirty word.
You would know.
We've arrived at that crossroad.
Huh?
And we chose anger and division.
Well, you egged
it
on.
My approach.
Oh, of course you
but
do.
But it's not what America wants right now.
No, we don't want you.
I love Arizona. And I am so proud of what we've delivered.
Uh-huh.
Because I choose civility, understanding, listening, working together to get stuff done.
Wait, okay, I got to pause it here. Because I chose civility, in what world is she civil? Understanding? Listening? You know, I just remember there's a video. I didn't pull any of it because the less I see of this woman, the better. And soon we'll see much less of her. She was on a plane and, as usual, dressed wholly inappropriately. Look, I'm no prude and I've been known to show off some cleavage. But she was on a plane with her boobage hanging out. And the only reason I know that is because a guy who was a passenger went up, you know, the aisle of the plane to go to the bathroom and saw Kyrsten Sinema sitting in an aisle seat. And he was shooting video on his camera, his phone. And, you know, from the angle where you're standing above, you can, he had a great view of the cleavage, which was there for all to see. And Kyrsten Sinema was there working on her computer with her boobs hanging out. And this guy said, I'm a constituent. Can I ask you a question? That was her response. She didn't look at him. She didn't acknowledge him. She completely ignored him. Again, he said, I'm a constituent, Senator Sinema. May I ask you a question? She acted as if he weren't there. So she chose civility, understanding, listening, working together?
Bullshit.
That's just
bullshit.
It's plain
bullshit.
Yeah. And what is she, Keith Olbermann? Because, you know, Kyrsten Sinema, when she was a state assembly person, before she even went to the state Senate, he used to put her on the air because she was a green, you know, liberal, you know. And but I guess he learned what she is. What is he, Keith? What is she, Keith? Oh, wrong one. What is she, Keith?
Asshole.
Oh, thank you. I know it was a long road to get there. Say it again, Keith. Come on, just one more time.
Asshole.
Yeah, she is. Okay, so keep going. Kyrsten, because you choose civility, understanding, listening, working together to get stuff done, what?
I will leave the Senate at the end of this year.
Yes! Yes!
Over
Go!
My career, I've shown how...
Okay, we don't need to hear anymore, do we? That's enough. She took like way too long to say that, and frankly, I've heard enough. she Kyrsten Sinema will not run again. Oh, that's music to my ears. So that means it is a two-person race. She would have run as an independent or a third-party person candidate because she is a woman without a party. So you have the great Ruben Gallego, who I really like, and then Carrie Lake. Now, I'd put the fuzzy, you know, focus on me if I had that feature, but I don't. But if you notice, Carrie Lake, anytime she gets in front of a camera, if she has control of the camera, she always goes for the soft focus. Ugh. Yes, Stephanie in the chat room said, Sinema is a con artist, just like George Santos. She is. She is. Yeah, so you know, she's gone. I feel no need to play the rest of it for you. But I do have to share this because it is classic. You're going to love this. So I know a lot of my friends and colleagues have left the shitter. You know, the site formerly known as Twitter, it's now known as X, but I don't call it X. It's X-I-T-T-E-R, which if the president or dictator of China's name is Xi, spelled X-I, X-I-T-T-E-R is shitter. If just so you know how my mind works, I don't just come up with words like this for the hell of it. So on the shitter, Kyrsten Sinema posted a message for Arizonans from Senator Kyrsten Sinema. So I wanted to see what the responses were. So let me share the Twitter feed with you because it's really good. Here's one from Nick at Nick Devon. So glad to see you saw the writing on the wall. No one to blame but yourself for turning on the people who voted you in office. Good riddance and good luck on your future endeavors. Then there was this person, Griffin W. Raines, who has a blue check next to his name. And you know, you only get those by paying for them. And who said, best to you, Kyrsten. Thanks for trying to bring people together.
Bullshit.
Okay, so there was that. My favorite, though, is somebody who posts under the name of alt-immigration. The actual Twitter or shitter handle is ALT_USCIS. And alt-immigration actually posted a few little videos in response. The first one being, I need to bring it up and play it for you from the beginning. So I got to turn the volume up. You ready? This is the first response to Kyrsten Sinema from this alt-immigration shitter account. And it's Jamie Foxx sitting at a piano in front of a microphone, and he sings...
Fuck you. Oh, fuck you, fuck you. Fuck you, fuck you.
All right. Not bad, huh? So that was his first one. Scroll down a little more. Here's Andrea RMD. Enjoy your well-deserved ratio and don't let the door hit you on the ass on the way out. Oh, here's the next one from Alt Immigration. Oh, I need to go over here because if you're watching the video feed, you'll see it's a picture of Kirsten in one of her lovely outfits, which we've been subjected to for the last too many years. So in this thing, she's wearing some yellow monstrosity with these big sleeves. And Alt Immigration posted the picture and said, it's time you return this parachute back to the Senate parachute office. We are airdropping food in Gaza, and we need it for a pallet of goat food. Okay. The next one, here is Alt Immigration again with yet another video, and it's another musical video. What is this one, Alt Immigration?
Suck a dick, suck a dick, suck a motherfucking dick. Suck a dick, suck a huge or small. Suck a dick.
Okay, so you get the idea of that one. The next one is another video. This one, there is music, but the music isn't the important thing. It's a guy on the floor clearing out strings of what appear to be cocaine or chalk or something, and he wipes off the top line. It says, hey, and the bottom line, it says, you, and then the middle line, fuck. Hey, fuck you, and he shoots the finger for good measure. Someone else, a meme, this is migraine level bullshit. Oh, and another from Alt Immigration. This is, I need to turn the sound up for this one because this person here comes running up with a giant dildo. yeah, and it goes on like that. Here's People for Bernie. Fixed her subtitle and whatever the caption said below her, they crossed it all out except for the word failure. So yes, you know, Brett Banditelli, who I actually know, responded with one word, loser. Here's an Sarah Burgess, who works at Raw Story, put a clown nose on Kirsten with one of her polka dot outfits. A few people, Alt Immigration again, posted the GIF, I never know how to say it correctly, of her. And this was the moment when pure hatred emanated from myself for her when she did the thumbs down thing in her little Catholic schoolgirl outfit, killing the bill that I think what this was killing the idea of killing the filibuster. You know, and then someone else it would get out of your algorithm, said Carrie Lake will do a much better job for the people of Arizona. Yeah, I don't think so. But anyway, the responses go on and on and on, and they are classic. I mean, it gets better and better and better. So if you want a good laugh, go to go to Kirsten Cinema's shitter feed. It's, by the way, at Senator spelled out Cinema, S-I-N-E-M-A. All I say is, you know, good riddance. Good, get out. Just go. Just leave already. Although I don't think her dirty work is done. Now the question is, what does she do next? Somebody said that they thought. One of the comments among many that I read was that she already has a part-time gig lined up at Fox. That's Kirsten Cinema. I have some good Kirsten Cinema stuff, but I didn't do it. Chris in the chat room said, I thought the outfit was Photoshop. No, that's her. She's like, look at me. I'm different than everybody else. Yeah. So, you know, it's women like Kirsten Cinema who I think give women a bad name. Now, the reason I didn't pull any Kirsten Cinema Sound was I was too busy trying to track down this guy. His name is Emmett Wilson. Is it Emmett Wilson or Emmett Martin? Emmett Martin. Sorry. For some reason, I have a thing. I keep thinking, well, anyway, his name is Emmett Martin. Emmett Martin is a voter in North Carolina. And, you know, today's Super Tuesday. So North Carolina is one of the states that's voting. So NBC News sends their, correspondent down to Graham, North Carolina, to talk to voters. You know how they do that, right? So to talk to voters. And, let me just share this little this clip with you. So Emmett Martin lives in Graham, North Carolina. There used to be, in the old days, I'm old, you used to dial 411 and you get directory assistance. And if you wanted to, get a number out of state, you would dial the area code plus 555-1212. I don't know if it works anymore, but all the white page sites and all those free phone lookup sites now charge you. So I wasted too much time today trying to find Emmett Martin's phone number. And why did I want to talk to him? Because he spoke to NBC News today, and you just have to hear it.
What do you think of Nikki Haley? Did you ever consider her?
What I got to say, you don't really want to put it on.
Let me hear it.
Well, a woman's not going to be a good president. She have no balls to scratch. She's just going to scratch her head. All a woman's good for in my book is having...
But I need to just put... Because, he's got that southern drawl. It's kind of hard to understand what he's saying. He's like, a woman's not going to be a good president because she got no balls to scratch. She's only going to scratch her head. That's really what he said. Here, listen again.
What I got to say, you don't really want to put it on...
Let me hear it.
Well... A woman's not going to be a good president. She have no balls to scratch.
Got no balls to scratch. Going to scratch her head.
All a woman's good for in my book is having babies and taking care of the house. But that's the...
All a woman's good for is having babies and taking care of a house.
Old thing, but I'm old school.
So you never even considered her?
No.
Mainly because she's a woman?
Because she's female. Females, don't take me wrong, females know what they're doing, but they still got to have a little bit of guidance. Trump would be the one to guide her through the CEO.
Okay, so, yes, I did really try to find that person. And, I found a place I can get the full name report for 95 cents. It's just the principle of the thing. You know what? The area code of Graham, North Carolina is 336. I wonder if there's still directory assistance. I'm going to find out. So if I go 1336, right? That's what I said. 336-555-1212. Let's see if it works. I don't know.
Thank you for calling the National Directory Assistance.
Huh.
What? Sorry, I didn't get that. Uh-oh. City,
Graham, North Carolina.
What city?
Graham.
This is Oliver for what city?
For Graham, North Carolina.
Graham. Thank you for what listing?
Emmett Martin.
Emmett Martin?
Yes.
I'm sorry that he's not listed.
Oh, no. No Emmett Martin, huh? Mm-hmm. Oh, well. All right. Thank you very much. Okay. Bye-bye. Well, I guess if I wanted to pay 95 cents, I'll probably be charged for that call. Although it didn't tell me. Yeah. Anyway. So I would like to talk to this guy because according to these sites that do the reverse lookup, he's married. He's got a wife. I wonder what she thinks about him saying that women are only good for having babies and keeping the house. Let me tell you something. I have a child, but I didn't give birth. I adopted her. And two, I don't keep the house. So what good am I? Graham. Emmett. Emmett. I don't know. All right. There's other stuff. While we wait for Lisa Graves, hopefully she'll be here any minute, we'll talk Supreme Court. But the other big bombshell story comes from Rolling Stone magazine, who the headline reads, Trump's White House was awash in speed and Xanax. Ronnie Jackson, that creepy so-called doctor, apparently his nickname was the Candyman. It says under Trump, the White House medical unit was like, quote, like the Wild West, and staffers had easy access to powerful stimulants and sedatives. So he would hand out Ambien, like if they were on a flight, go down the aisle and hand out Ambien so everyone would sleep. And then when it was time to wake up, he would give them this drug called Provigil, which wakes you up. Now, you know, I've told you I don't sleep at night, and so sometimes I have trouble staying awake. And there is another drug called Nuvigil that I have taken. It's awesome because you don't get speedy like you get on speed, but it's the awake pill. I use them very rarely, only when I'm, you know, like narcoleptic and can't stay awake and need to. But oh my goodness. He was handing these things out like candy. And now, of course, I can't find it. But there are like manifests of priceless of how many drugs were handed out by this White House. I saw a great meme that said something to the effect of, the Republicans had this huge war on drug and spent billions and billions of dollars. And their doctor was just handing it out like candy. And everyone in the White House was high all the time. It's opposite world. It really is opposite world. All right. So let's see. While we wait for Lisa Graves, I told you about all this other stuff. So, all right. So now we're on to the Supreme Court. She will be along hopefully any minute. In fact, I'll get the shot set up. So the minute she joins us, you know, I can just go over to her. But let me share with you, actually, what do I have to do here? All right, so she's going to be there, 7. A little bit of what Spocko wrote, because again, thank goodness for Spocko, who's out being a poll watcher today. It is Super Tuesday. Have you voted? In Arizona, our election day apparently isn't for, I think, 2 more weeks. But we did get our presidential preference ballots in the mail and returned them. That's why I have my I voted sticker here on my microphone. And it will remain there to remind everyone that we need to do that. And oh, I see Lisa's here. And I'm just going to bring her on because we can. Lisa, I'm so sorry. I'm time zone challenged. I have been since I moved here. And what I was saying is next week when the rest of the country springs forward, we don't. So I'll be even further time zone challenged. So instead of going on the air at 3:00 Arizona time, I'll be going on at 2:00. So while everyone just loses an hour of sleep one night, I lose an hour of show prep every day for the next 6 months.
That's awful.
Thinking, oh, I get off easy. Finally, I'm going to somewhere where they don't observe daylight savings time. And yeah, thanks so much, Arizona. I'll blame it on Kyrsten Sinema, who's leaving. Yeah. So Lisa Graves. I love talking to Lisa Graves, and especially when there's big legal news, because Lisa is an expert. She was I always get it wrong, but I'm going to read it this time. You are a Deputy Assistant Attorney General at the U.S. Department of Justice in the Office of Legal Policy and Policy Development under both Janet Reno and Richard Ashcroft, John Ashcroft.
John.
Richard Ashcroft was in the band Verve. I always get them mixed up, and I usually take a pause. Wait, no. Richard is the musician.
They are nothing alike, as you know.
Nothing. I know. And it's, yeah, I do that. It's like Igor and Igor since watching Young Frankenstein. If I ever talk to someone named Igor, I have to take a beat. And so Igor was Young Frankenstein, and Igor is the pronunciation of the name. Certain things just trip me up as I get older. You were also served as chief counsel for nominations for the U.S. Senate Judiciary Committee under Senator Patrick Leahy. These days, Lisa runs True North Research, where they do amazing exposes. They'll tell us the things we need to know about dark money and Leonard Leo and all the bad guys versus the good guys. But she appears on this program as a private citizen, sharing her legal expertise. So, Lisa, finally, after 3 weeks, the Supreme Court surprised most of us. Did you think they were going to take up the case of Donald Trump's so-called absolute immunity, or let the D.C. Circuit Court, who had a 3-judge panel, write a very in-depth, conclusive opinion written by all 3 of the judges that made it easy for the Supreme Court to say, we're not going to take this case. We're going to let the lower court ruling stand. That's what I thought was going to happen. What about you?
Yeah, the lower court, in that case, the D.C. Circuit, wrote, as you point out, a very compelling unanimous opinion about how ridiculous Trump's claims of absolute immunity were. And so the easiest thing in the world and the right thing in the world would have been for the Supreme Court to not take that case, to deny cert. This court is very experienced at denying cert. More than 8,000 cert petitions are filed with it every year.
Right.
It only took 60 cases in this past year, more or less, maybe 61 now. And so it could have done what it has done to thousands of other cases, which is let the lower court ruling stand. But at least 4 justices on that Supreme Court that's controlled by this right-wing faction chose to take this case up, presumably because they think they have a fifth vote to do something. And so it was not just a surprise that they took it up, but alarming. Although I suppose it's not so much of a surprise, since this court leans so far to the right, is so willing to put its thumb on the scale of justice to advance the Republican agenda at almost every turn.
So it was a unanimous 9-0 decision, although
in the other case.
Wait, that
not the immunity case, but in the Colorado case. Yeah.
Oh, in the Colorado case. I'm all confused. So they gave us 2 things here. Okay, the Colorado case, they had to decide that quickly because today's Super Tuesday in Colorado was voting.
No. Colorado, yes. Yeah, got it. Okay,
So Trump is on the ballot. And furthermore, let's deal with that one now, because I'm conflating the two, because it's so easy to get them confused. So they ruled 9-0 that the states can't remove Trump from the ballot, that this is a decision that has to go through Congress. Well, didn't Congress, in its impeachment, its second impeachment, basically say that Trump was guilty of participating in an insurrection? Because they said that it's got to go to Congress to say that. Explain to me what I have wrong here. Probably everything.
Well, it's not that you have it wrong. It's that the sort of spin coming out of the ruling has puts a number of things together. So let me just say from my perspective, in my opinion, it was certainly disappointing that 9 justices ruled against Colorado removing Trump from the ballot. Mm-hmm. That's where there was, in essence, agreement that that you couldn't have some sort of patchwork where one state removed someone from the ballot and other states did not. I don't see any patchwork language in the Constitution. And in fact, the Constitution has the states as a patchwork.
That's part of
what we experience. And the idea that one state could have an effect on the outcome of a presidential race. Hello, Bush v. Gore. So it's not as though we don't accept the patchwork or the notion that one state maybe has a disproportionate impact. Hello, Wyoming versus California.
Yes.
That's a non-standard dodge, in essence, to say we just can't have a situation where one state leaves them on the ballot and one state does not. The court, that 9-vote thing, in essence, did not actually undo or contend with, assert, in essence, that Congress had not already found that Trump engaged in insurrection. There was no effort to revisit that. In fact, as you point out, the House, the majority of the House found that Trump engaged in insurrection. That's what the impeachment, the second impeachment,
and
is based
on. And the majority
on.
Of the Senate did, too. Yeah. They didn't get enough to convict him, but it was like 57 to whatever, right?
Yeah, it was 57 votes for conviction, which was a supermajority, just not a big enough supermajority under the Constitution
three
to actually
more.
Impeach him.
They needed three more.
But that nine, that, and that's the extent of the nine vote agreement. In reality, this is a 5-4 decision, or 5-3-1. And by that, I mean five of the Republican appointees to the court then went on to claim that Congress had to enact affirmative legislation in order to remove someone or block someone from sitting who had engaged in insurrection. Amy Coney Barrett did not agree with that. And neither did the three Democratic appointees to the court. So it's 5-4.
Thank you for calling them that. And not the liberals. Yes. Go ahead.
Emphasizing that, because a 5-4 decision here is really an illegitimate decision, because it really should have been a 4-4 tie. Hmm. And I say that because Clarence Thomas had no business sitting on that case whatsoever.
Oh,
he should have recused himself. It's outrageous that he sat on that case when his wife was actively engaged in trying to overturn that election, not just texting Mark Meadows at all hours of the day to try to, you know, urge him to not let these votes be counted, but also affirmatively reaching out to legislators in Arizona, your state, and in Wisconsin, at least those states for sure, we know, probably more, to urge them to also not certify the election, not to allow the bona fide electors to go to Congress, or those votes from bona fide electors to go to Congress to elect Joe Biden president. And so it's really a 4-4 decision, meaning it should have no precedential value whatsoever, is non-binding on the Congress. And in fact, like, the thing that's just outrageous. And I'm just going to read it because I know that you indulge me sometimes. But the thing about, this is my little copy of the Constitution.
Nice.
Amendment, the 14th Amendment, Section 3, bars anyone who's engaged in insurrection, rebellion against the government of the United States, or giving comfort to the enemies thereof, is barred. And then it has a sentence that's really important. But Congress may, by a vote of 2/3 by each house, remove such disability. How can it be a disability? How can it be a bar that exists as it exists in reality, other than with the Supreme Court, if it can only be removed by a 2/3 vote of each house of Congress? And so their reading is just completely counterfactual. It's counterhistorical. It's counter language. You can't have a situation which the plain language of the Constitution says this bar exists basically forever unless 2/3 of the House and Senate vote to remove that bar. In this way, this 4 vote with the illegitimate Thomas vote, 5 vote, quote, majority, that said that the only way to block someone from, you know, running for office, being in office for insurrection, is if Congress creates affirmative legislation allowing a procedure for barring someone, is, I'm going to say the word I always say when this comes up, bullshit. I know.
Bullshit.
Yes. Because anyone, whether you're a Republican, a Democrat, an independent, a constitutional scholar, a lay person, a law student, if the Constitution says this bar can be removed by a 2/3 vote, that doesn't mean you need any affirmative legislation to effectuate it. And in fact, as the dissent pointed out, or the so-called concurrence of the three Democratic appointees points out, every other provision of the 14th Amendment is self-executing. And by self-executing, meaning you don't need to have affirmative legislation in order to invoke that clause under the Constitution, the protection of the law clause and other clauses. In fact, most of the Constitution is self-executing. The First Amendment, self-executing. The Fourth Amendment, self-executing. Now, what happened historically with the 14th Amendment was that it was a constitutional amendment because it had been a statute before it was an amendment. Mm-hmm. And the people who wrote that statute were worried that a future mere majority would come in and wipe away the protections for newly freed slaves. Oh. So the 13th Amendment was written, passed in 1865 to say that you can't enslave people. Of course, the regressive parts of our society were like, okay, we won't enslave you. You just won't have any rights. So then Congress passed a bill to say, you know, it's not just you can't enslave people, but you can't deny people the right to have contracts or employment or, you know, that sort of thing. And so they then decided that they had to put that into the Constitution as a supermajority thing so that it was those rights were protected. And that's what the first part of the 14th Amendment says, you know, no person shall be denied equal protection of the law. If you're born in the United States, you have certain rights, that sort of thing. So this majority, which is a per curiam opinion, meaning it's anonymous, written by a coward, it's a cowardly member of that set of Republican appointees, then said, because Congress had passed legislation to implement certain parts of the 14th Amendment, for example, the specific language that you have an equal right to equal protection of law, meaning you can't be denied housing or accommodation in the Civil Rights Act of 1964. That didn't mean you didn't have that right. It just meant you didn't have a statute that really clarified what, you know, kind of what that meant, that you can't, like, equal protection means, of course, you can stay at a hotel. So they basically used that to say that you had to have implementing legislation for this Section 3, which is bogus because Section 3, as I began this part of the conversation with you and now I've gone on too long.
No, please.
Says it exists unless Congress, by a 2/3 vote, removes the disability.
You know, this reminds me of what, and I get confused now because there's so many of these legal questions going back and forth. But it was like with the prosecution of Trump. First, they said, well, in order to criminally indict him, you need to impeach him, and he needs to be convicted by the Senate. Well, and then in the Senate, they're like, well, Mitch McConnell says, well, we won't be able to impeach him, but the courts will deal with him when he gets out of office because he'll be held accountable for the crimes he's committed. It's sort of a catch-22, isn't it? It's like
it's more than a catch-22 because, in fact, the Trump lawyers argued that. They claimed that you couldn't be impeached unless you were indicted.
Right.
And now they've claimed that you can't be indicted unless you've been impeached.
Hello?
And so it's, yeah, and so it's an impossibility. But I was just saying, Nicole, I wish I'd mentioned this to you when we were talking about coming on, because this court reminds me of one of my favorite Seinfeld episodes when Kramer gets a line in a play, and the line is, "These pretzels are making me thirsty," and then they all do like, "These pretzels and these pretzels are," and they're making me thirsty. They all do an emphasis, like, how do you say that line?
Word. Right,
because this court is making me cranky.
You know, tell me about it.
We're hearing way too much from this court. This court is playing way too big a role in American society. It's, you know, just creating law out of whole cloth. It's ignoring the laws that exist in order to impose their agenda. This court, we should not, this court is its own version of Trump in a sense that, like, we do not need this much court happening on our daily news, in our daily lives. But we are, because it's such a political court, you know, it's acting as a political actor in reaching out to try to basically advance that Republican agenda in every way they can.
Didn't you call them politicians in robes?
Yes. Yes. I mean, it's regrettable because I have a great deal of reverence for judges who actually are fair and impartial. I believe that, you know, the core notion of why would you ever submit your dispute you're having with someone to a court unless you hope that that court would rule fairly, whether it's a divorce or a contract or, you know, a criminal proceeding or a civil proceeding. The whole reason we have a court system is because people sometimes can't resolve things themselves.
Sure.
They take things to their own bias. They read things in their own way. The court is supposed to be neutral. That's why all the historical depictions of courts in the modern era, meaning, you know, the last couple hundred years, the court is holding a scale of justice, and the scale of justice is equal. And right. Often the court is displayed, Lady Justice is displayed as blind.
Right. Well, I don't know if now when I have you on, this is the show card that I put up. This is our logo for when you're
the
show.
You're looking at this imbalance.
Right.
Yeah.
It's the scale's imbalanced, and Lady Justice is peeking out from under the blindfold.
I love that, right? Nicole.
I didn't even know.
I teed that up perfectly.
You did. And I started using that, I think, just last week, the last time you were on the the show. It's like, that's the perfect graphic for when you're on because of what we're talking about. Lisa Gray, so I've got a question for you. You can see it's typed up here, and I promised I would read it verbatim.
Okay.
Since the 10th Amendment to the Constitution reserves all, quote, powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution nor prohibited by it to the states, other than the fact that the extreme court is dominated by morally bankrupt, corrupted shit stains, why in the actual fucking fuck was the Colorado case not decided on that basis?
Well,
it's a question from my husband. So,
I appreciate the intensity of emotion in that. You know, I would say that one of my frustrations over the years is that certain parts of the Constitution have basically been read out of meaning by this right-wing court. And it's been a right-wing court for a long time. Really, in the last 50 years, I think it's something like 2/3 of the appointees to this court have been from Republican presidents, only 1/3 by Democratic presidents. And some of that has been gamed, as we saw with Trump, where they stole two seats. The seat
yes,
that when Scalia died in 2016 and the seat when Ginsburg died, less than two months before the election. But even then, if you look at the court in, you know, since 1970, basically, or thereabouts, this court has been dominated by the right wing. But well before this Supreme Court of the modern era came around, the court that was in power after the civil rights, after the Civil War amendments back in the 1860s, it was also a regressive court, and it did everything to read the language of the Constitution out of meaning. So for example, it said that the privileges and immunity of citizenship, you know, basically don't apply to Black Americans. They apply to businesses. You know, like, we're going to take this 14th Amendment that plainly was written to secure the rights of people who were recently freed from slavery, and we're going to say it doesn't apply to them, this privileged immunities, but we're going to apply it to a corporation. And, you know, and you can see that history likewise with the 9th Amendment, the 10th Amendment. The 9th Amendment is the amendment along with the 10th, these catch-all amendments that were part of the Bill of Rights. That has also been read out of meaning, unless it advances a conservative meaning, right wing agenda. So the 9th Amendment said the enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. Others retained by the people. That too has been basically discredited by a long series of right wing judges who don't want to recognize what that 9th Amendment says, which is that there are other rights than those that are specified here to be free from unreasonable search and seizure, for example, or the right to trial. So when you take that and put it together with this privileges and immunities of citizenship, which is part of the 14th Amendment, what you have is an effort by Congress and by these amendments to say that people have these, you know, rights that should not be disparaged. But in fact, what's happened is the court has not been our friend, not been the friend of the American people, in essence, has not been reading the Constitution to protect people's rights for most of its history, and very aggressively so right now. And so this court would never have allowed that 10th Amendment argument that was made in your question to be used to ensure that, of course, Colorado could take this on. And the other thing that I think the question relates to, David's question relates to, is that for all these other in all these other ways, we rely on the state to administer our federal elections.
Yes.
Like, that's their role,
right.
You know?
Right.
Yeah.
So should
we don't
they
have
be able
national
to decide?
Popular vote.
No.
We don't, you know, it'd be great if we had national popular vote. We don't have national popular vote.
That's
we
right.
have federal elections administered by states, setting those rules. And in fact, not just that, you have a Supreme Court right now, this Roberts Court, which has tried to remove the power of federal judges to oversee matters involving the drawing of maps and districts. Like,
right.
So basically, for only in very rare circumstances are they saying that they will allow a federal court to intervene in a terribly drawn map that basically skews the election to create minority rule. And so in that, they're like, oh no, the states, that's where the states would handle that. You know, and so you have a situation in which this court has no principle. These five anonymous judges who issued this ruling, including the illegitimate Clarence Thomas and his illegitimate participation in this case. And by illegitimate, I don't mean by birth, I mean by action. But you have a ruling that is counter to the language of the 14th Amendment, counter to our the way elections have been administered over time, counter to history, and just really in service of, in my view, protecting Trump. Unfortunately, because of this practical argument about patchworks, these four other judges, Amy Coney Barrett and the three appointees by Democratic presidents, went along with the ruling to avoid inconsistency among the states. But, you know, as far as I've been hearing all of my life and certainly all of my legal career, that's what the states are. Right. They have their own now, of course, I believe that there are standards, like you can't just have a state deny people, you know, basic rights, that there's a floor.
But there's a paragraph you can cite in the Constitution that's just like my 25-year-old daughter can't run for president because she's not 35 and she wasn't born in the United States. Right?
No, that's right. That's exactly right. These provisions do not require a statute to say this has effect. And so it's a totally artificial construction by partisan politicians, basically, who wear judicial robes and who at this point seem to have no feeling of obligation to neutrality other than the pretense of it, like the way they wrote that decision to pretend that, of course, this is what the law required.
Right.
But I challenge people to read the Colorado decision and not be persuaded by it. Colorado Supreme Court's decision was well-reasoned. It was consistent with the law, history, facts. This anonymous, cowardly decision, this cowardly partisan decision by five judges that articulate this completely bogus notion that Congress, 150 years later, you know, was supposed to have passed some sort of implementing legislation. I mean, let me just pause and say, the people who wrote the 14th Amendment are rolling over in their graves if I believe such a thing were possible.
Exactly. I gotcha. You know, Lisa Graves, you wrote a piece just about the beginning of February that was in Common Dreams. The headline is Clarence Thomas Has No Shame, but you knew that. And the subtitle is Not Recusing in a Case Such as This is Unprecedented. It's wrong. And it's an appalling testament to how corrupted, how political, and how morally bankrupt the Roberts Court really is. I will link to that from the blog entry today where I post the show at NicoleSandler.com/3-5-24 by the date. It's always there. Easily shareable or not behind a paywall. But read, you wrote that last month, and it's astounding that he refuses to recuse himself from these cases where he has an obvious conflict of interest. His wife, I don't know why she hasn't been indicted for anything and hasn't been charged like one of the January 6th insurrectionists. But there's a lot of things I don't understand about all this. In fact, did a ruling from the court yesterday or late last week have something to do with overturning some of the convictions of the January 6th insurrectionists?
Yes, there was a recent ruling that basically, in effect, said that you couldn't have a sentence enhancer of interfering with justice because it wasn't interfering with a court, even though it was interfering with a legal process, meaning the counting of our ballots in our presidential election, which is, I would submit to you, far more important than, one interfering in one singular case, one district court somewhere where, you know, but interfering in the actual legal process of how our votes are counted. And the purpose of that insurrection was precisely that. It was not just like, I'm just going to randomly go walk around the Capitol. The purpose was to stop the counting of the vote. I actually think the true purpose was to create such chaos that Trump would, if a member had been killed, I have no doubt that Trump would have declared martial law. Use the fact of his fans creating this chaos and violence as a basis for declaring martial law and saying, look, we're gonna have to have a do-over. You know, we just can't have these ballots counted. And I don't think we would have ever been able to remove him, from office because he would not have gone. But the purpose of that insurrection, the beating of the police, the stabbing them with flagpoles and more, was to stop the vote being counted. And that certainly is, in my view, an interference with the process, with the legal process And it should not just be confined to the courts. But like you point out, you're so on top of these things, Nicole, this U.S. Supreme Court basically has now allowed for that enhancement for sentences, for some of the sentences to be dropped. So again, helping Trump's allies or Trump at every turn.
And then the other one that I conflated with the Colorado case, the other ruling that came after waiting 3 weeks when we thought there's no way they're going to hear this Donald Trump's ridiculous claim of something called absolute immunity that doesn't exist.
It's not in here, just for the record.
No, it's not in there, right?
In there. Yeah,
and so they wait 3 weeks to say, yeah, we'll hear the case and we'll do it at the end of the calendar. So the week of April 22nd, no rush. What?
Yeah, it's an extraordinary intervention. This court cannot be trusted with our rights, with our law, quite frankly. It cannot be trusted to rule consistent with precedent. I think, you know, to me, what's happening with this court between the Dobbs decision destroying Roe, between the voting rights decision destroying key enforcement voting rights decision, between the gun decision claiming, in essence, that you can't have a gun law that basically didn't exist or its counterpart didn't exist in 1789 or 91, when women didn't even have a right to hold a piece of property, appear in court as a witness, be on a jury, vote, et cetera. We didn't have domestic violence laws back then. We didn't have, you know, this court is out of control. It's got to be curbed. We're going to have a real movement to reform the court in order to restore our rights and our democracy. And I'm eager to be part of that effort to help restore our rights, because this court has betrayed its oath. In my view, it's betrayed it's betrayed the Constitution. And it's also countenancing just outright corruption in the actions of Clarence Thomas, both his actions in terms of taking gifts and others, Alito as well, and more, but certainly Clarence Thomas, and then his refusal to recuse himself. And then these justices, not one of them writing an opinion to say it's inappropriate for him to be on that case. Enough with the emperor having no clothes. No, we have to call it as it is as citizens. We can't rely on this court to do the right thing by the Constitution, by our law, or I think really, quite frankly, by morality, because Thomas's conduct himself, his conduct has been so fundamentally immoral, but also the fact of his wife's deep involvement in trying to overturn our election is just fundamentally at odds with him participating in this case. And quite frankly, he should be impeached. He should be removed from the court. And if I ever get a chance to help with an effort to impeach him, I will drop whatever I'm doing and do it.
Awesome. Now, is there any way to encourage, whether it's Jack Smith or someone else, to bring Ginni Thomas up on charges? What she's done cannot be legal, or is it? Is there no law governing the spouse of a Supreme Court justice from getting involved in a coup?
Well, I found her statements to the January 6th committee to be like completely unbelievable. Quite frankly, it was dissembling in my view. And certainly we've learned since the initial January 6th investigation how deeply she was involved in trying to get these fake electors in these states, you know, writing state legislators to urge them to participate in this completely fake process. But we haven't seen that kind of criminal investigation happening in Arizona or in Wisconsin, where those materials are on the record. I don't know if she did so in Georgia, where there obviously is an active criminal prosecution going on. I've got to check the statute of limitations on, you know, kind of is the clock running out. But I think she should be held accountable. I wish that the word is that the sort of.
Oh no!
Rumor is, although I don't usually talk about rumors, but the rumor is that for the I might have frozen there.
You did, but you're back.
But the rumor is that the rumor is that the January 6th committee and Liz Cheney wanted to really stay focused on Trump, and the Trump White House did not want to get embroiled in, bringing in Ginni Thomas and the Supreme Court into this fight because of worries about. That tainting the court. And and my response is the court has been tainted by Ginni's actions. It's been tainted by Clarence's actions, and nothing Congress would have done to investigate that further would have tainted it. It would have just shined a light on the taint that exists.
Exactly. So whose responsibility? Who can we get to like lead the effort to do something here? I feel like we're just sitting back and going, oh, they fucked us again.
Well, I mean, there are, I think, I mean, people are reeling from the decision yesterday. So there, you know, I think people are thinking like, what can we do? What can be done in terms of the actual ballots? In essence, nothing can be done because now those ballots are going to go out with an insurrectionist on board. Then by nothing, I mean, nothing can be done to remove his name from the ballot. However, what can be done and what must be done, and this is, again, my personal opinion, is we have to vote against the insurrectionist and the insurrectionist party. We have to get everyone we know to vote against the insurrectionist, Donald Trump, and the insurrectionist party that supports him, and say, this is not who our country is, and defend our democracy, because our democracy literally is hanging in the balance, because there is no scenario in which Trump leaves office if he gets that office again. There's no scenario in which he follows a Supreme Court ruling, even if we were to miraculously get a ruling against him, which he would ever follow it.
Yeah.
There's actually no scenario in which he would even follow Congress's lead on something. He's just going to act and dare the other branches to stop him. And the other branches are don't have the tools to actually stop him when he has the some people in the military that he would choose to lead the military in his pocket. And so this is a life or death vote for the future of our democracy. And I don't say that lightly. I've never said that before about an election, but after what happened on January 6th, this is the last election America will ever have that will have any legitimacy if Donald Trump is returned to office, because he will never allow us to have an honest, real election again. It'll just be like Putin or Orban. It'll just be one of these sham situations. And
you mean Orban, who he just met with at Mar-a-Lago yesterday?
Yes.
That Orban, yeah. Viktor Orban, yes. The dictator of Hungary, not yes. Turkey, as he has said publicly, but Hungary. Are you okay on time? Do you? I know we're running long, and
I can stay for about 4 to 6 more minutes.
Okay, because David's here and he's got another question.
Well, first I have to say thank you, Lisa, for your answer to my previous question, and my current question is: do you know Kyrsten Sinema has a bunch of money in her? I'm using air quotes here, campaign account. Now that she's not running, will she be allowed to somehow keep that money?
Well, you know, this is another area. You know, there's so many areas of the law, David, where when you look at them, you go, well, this should be fixed. it should be changed. Not keep it in her personal capacity, meaning to buy clothes for herself. But those campaign accounts can then be spent, on other candidates, on other expenses, on litigation, theoretically, although it would be a transfer of funds. That money does not go into the treasury. It doesn't go into the public charity. It remains, in essence, in control of that campaign. Right. And so it remains to be seen what will happen to those funds, how they'll be spent. And I hope there are watchdogs keeping an eye on it.
I hope so, too. And I'm sure there are. By the way, Lisa, I just have to let you know how much I appreciate you coming here. I just glanced up at the chat room and I see, of course, now I lost it. I love every minute we can get with Lisa.
Aw.
The chat room, they love you as I do. When I say Lisa Graves will be here tomorrow, it's like, yeah, Lisa's coming. Because you're, and the comments, oh, my God, she's so smart. You have the answers to these questions and you know what it should be. And you've been there. I mean, you've got the chops to back up the experience. I thank you for your expertise because, as you can tell, I don't even play a lawyer on the radio.
I appreciate you. And like I said, it's been so complicated. It's like case after case after case. It's hard to keep them straight. You're brilliant and insightful and wonderful, Nicole. I adore being on your show. And thank you so much to your listeners for tuning in and for those kind words. And I hope you all have a lovely rest of the day. And like I said, like, what do we do?
Vote.
Get our friends to vote. Make sure our friends are voting. Make sure the neighbor is voting. Make sure people understand what the stakes are, because we cannot allow this path of destruction to continue. We have got to choose a better path. And that is a path, in my view, that does not involve, this court continue to operate so in such disregard for our precedents and not having someone in the White House, in my personal view, like Trump, who would actually never leave. He might appoint his son and then leave.
Here's the thing. He could get in. He could die in office. He could make the pillow guy or you know, Tucker Carlson, his running mate, and that person could become president. You know, in years past, I would say, oh, come on now. But this is could actually happen.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's, it sounds like, I mean, the speculation is it could be Kristi Noem of South Dakota, the one who was so willing to basically do his bidding there in South
Dakota.
Because
she's pretty. So that fits his narrative.
It's like an optics thing. But but there's no guarantee it could be a politician, meaning someone who has any experience in governance. It could be someone who has an experience in cocaine, like Mark, like Lindell. Not that that's a disqualifier. Apparently.
Or Don Jr.
Don Jr. But, you know, like you know, he's supposedly reformed or whatever, but his appearances do not make him seem like a reasonable person. No. Someone who may not, you know, be imbibing. I don't know. But the fact is that Lindell is unhinged. Whatever the cause of that being unhinged is very disturbing. And there is nothing that would prevent Donald Trump from choosing him. Or someone else unfit for office, and not because of past drug use. That's not a disqualifier in America, but just someone who has such a lack of judgment and such hysteria and a lack of affinity for truth, like Mike Lindell. You know, it's shocking to me that he even has a platform, quite frankly. And also, you know, pillows do not give you the qualification. Selling pillows is no qualification for public policy. I'm not a total snob. I believe people have right to run for office, but why anyone would listen to anything he says about anything other than pillows, I have no idea.
I don't know either. But then, you know, he's talking about Byron Donalds, who is this, you know, I think a second term congressman from Florida, who's an idiot. So tomorrow I have on the show Tom Schaller and Paul Waldman, who have this new book about white rural Americans and the white nationalist problem that they have in racism. Well, somebody named Michael Steele Michael Cohen wrote a column at the Daily Beast about this book and saying, yeah, they have it right. Basically, middle America is filled with racists, and obviously I'm paraphrasing. Byron Donalds went ballistic saying Michael Cohen, Trump's former lawyer, wrote this thing. It's like, oh my God, there's a incompetent assholes who don't know how to read and don't know that Michael Cohen is a fairly common name. And and this guy is now being floated as a possible vice presidential pick. I'm sick of the stupid. I just give
well,
us...
you know, it's funny because in the Bush era, I'm sure you recall there was
a lot of it.
there was a movie about the dumbing down of American democracy. I've completely lost the name of it, but it was about how it was a satire, basically. And the presidency had suddenly become occupied by Comancho, a former wrestler, and people were drinking like Gatorade or something as part of some sort of American diet. I'll find it and send the link to you. But the essence of it was that America got dumber and dumber and dumber. It was sort of like Dumb and Dumberer for the presidency or something, basically.
We're living it. We've been living it.
Yeah, at the time, it seemed so far-fetched. And yet, this cast of characters that has surrounded Trump has, you know, sort of renewed the sort of possible reality of that satire. Although it's not realistic, but like... It's just
neither is Trump. You know, the whole story of Donald Trump becoming president and all the insanity surrounding the stealing of the Supreme Court seats. If this were 20 years ago and somebody presented this screenplay, Donald Trump becomes president, they would have been laughed out of every office in Hollywood. It's like,
well, that's right. That's right. And that does bring me to, like, I guess, end on a more serious or sober note, which is it's genuinely shocking for me after, you know, the beginning of this century was 9/11. The notion that we would now have someone in the presidency, or, you know, having been in the presidency and seeking the presidency again, who has such disrespect for American, you know, American law, our freedoms, Constitution, veterans, you know, his disparaging comments about veterans. I can't believe, like, I never would have believed that was possible. That this sort of candidate would be even polling at 50% in the Republican Party, given where that party was and where America was, you know, 20, 23 years ago. It's genuinely shocking to have someone who I'm certain that Donald Trump has not read the Constitution beginning to end. He didn't read he has no, and oaths mean nothing to him.
Nothing.
An oath to uphold the Constitution means nothing to him. He violated it willfully in trying to stay in office. And it makes me very sad about the state of our country that there is some subset of people who would be persuaded by this man. It makes me sad that their lives would allow them to be so receptive to someone who's such a documented crook, someone who has you know, been indicted, someone who has, cheated workers out of their pay, disregarded, the whole thing of Donald Trump. But the thing is that a majority of Americans rejected him in 2020. And in the elections between his election in 2016, there's been a wave of progressives and moderates and independents in 2018, 2020, 2022, these Supreme Court races last year at the state level, Ohio's abortion ballot, so even though it saddens me that he's still persuasive to, some part of the population, I believe at least so far that the majority of voters, when they're in the ballot booth, have voted against his vision for America. So I think we have to be hopeful about that and find more people who agree that we do not want to have this total destruction of American democracy and our economy due to his awful, awful policies, right. His awful agenda, and his, in my personal view, lack of utter contempt for morality of any kind. Basically.
Absolutely. We have our marching orders. We've all got to be evangelists for the vote and for saving our democracy. You stated it perfectly in there. I'm going to pull out that clip and I'm going to play it a lot, because this will be our last real election. If he gets back in office, we can call it a day.
So let's not end this experiment. Instead of having him break the arc of progress, toward justice, let's, hold up that arc toward justice and reject this extreme and regressive and repressive agenda that he and so many of his operatives represent, and get the 21st century on the right track. So Please. Anyway, Nicole, it was a joy to be on. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. You're the best. You Lisa Grace. Right. Check out truenorthresearch.org and see the work that Lisa's doing in her day job. And I'll also link to the Common Dreams piece about Clarence Thomas, which is a must read as well. Lisa Graves, you're the best. Thank you so much. We will talk soon.
Bye.
And with that, we're done for today. Again, tomorrow, as I told you, Tom Schaller and Paul Waldman will be here. Their new book is Creating Waves. This story with Byron Donalds is batshit crazy, but everything dealing with today's Republican Party is. So, all right. Tuesday. Tomorrow's Wednesday. All right. And next week, Barb McQuaid's going to be here. So we got that going for us. All right. Have a great night, everyone. Thank you for listening. As always, thanks to Lisa Graves, and I will see you tomorrow. Peace out.